first, so I make sure I have time for them. Blueberries, Bob Wills. Who's questioning blueberries? Good question. The question is, should you drop the pH and minimize calcium? No. You should treat blueberries just like you treat everything else. End of story. If you want more.
End of story, it's been proven, man.
It's proven, it's solid. If you want to have 1,000% the antioxidant levels of your neighbors, get the pH up and fill the tank of minerals and feed the plant. If you want to have, you know, generally weak, but something. Eric bought blueberries in the store. He tasted that pulp they call blueberry. Good way to get that is have a nice low pH and no calcium. And yeah, if you want exquisite blueberries, do the same thing you're doing for everything else. Blueberries can function in a low pH environment. That does not mean they prefer to function in a low pH environment. It's like rice can function underwater, but does not prefer to function underwater. Lazy farmers in the olden days flooded their rice so they didn't have to weed. Now lazy farmers use black plastic. Anybody? All right.
And the yields are significantly higher, multiples of standard yield.
Absolutely.
Even with the best modern agriculture you can get, you can still triple your yield.
By taking the water out.
With those methods, yeah.
Yeah. The most inspiring global food, you know, movement where you've got millions of farmers who are absolutely, you know, on the edge, succeeding on the planet. I mean, millions and millions of farmers in dozens of countries, millions of acres, totally grassroots, no organization, nobody's selling anything. Look it up. It's called System of Rice Intensification, SRI, or System of Crop Intensification, SCI. It's totally grassroots. It's totally farmer to farmer. They're having, you know, they're making world records with potato yields per acre, rice yields per acre, the most documented ever.
It's phenomenal. The problem is
absolutely
the story, I mean, it's hard to, they don't speak English much. So
that's
when you go to watch.
That's not a problem for them.
Yeah, it's not a problem for us.
It's a problem for us,
yeah. Yeah, I wish.
They're actually doing amazing work talking to each other and really empowering, doing real systemic work. You want to talk about where solutions are being manifested. This is absolutely amazing.
Is it because of the internet? Is that what's
happening? It certainly helped. It certainly helped. The ability to share information, absolutely. There's a professor at Cornell who's helping to get the word out, named Norman Lupoff. If you want somebody who speaks English to take serve as a you know, intermediary, Norman Lupoff. I think he's actually a emeritus professor.
That's really impressive stuff.
It's brilliant. It's absolutely stupendous. No one in this country's heard of it. You know, we're all depressed. I think that's our country's sick.
Yeah.
There's amazing things going on all over the world.
Sorry. Are these guys doing stuff by hand?
Yes.
Everything. Machine, hand. They're basically following basic biological practices. They're doing a lot of the stuff we're talking about here. Basic biological management. Take out the chemicals, you know, do a little bit of inoculation. So some cover cropping, some, you know, composting, basic.
That was impressive with the tillage. I mean, have you seen their tillage tools in that rice that they got that made?
Yeah.
You'd think that with the tillage, it would actually be destroying stuff, but it actually, they say that particular tillage enhances it. And I was trying to figure out
if
they were working on
biodynamic. There's hundreds of thousands of people doing different things and experimenting and showing different things.
Yeah.
There's different people. It's very interesting. There's no like authoritative account or best way of doing it. It's all being spread grassroots. Okay, I mentioned questions here, not getting distracted with inspiring things. Wake up, no more inspiration, we don't have time for that. In action. Waking up, steep pasture, did I give you enough of that?
Yep, I think so.
All right. Start with sod, what do you do now? I was gonna do that with late on minerals. Okay, late on minerals. So for those people who think this is all very inspiring and haven't done any homework and gotten their minerals out into the ground yet, what do you do? I would still put them out as soon as possible. Whatever green sand, rock, phosphate, gypsum, et cetera, you think you need. Trace elements, you know, copper, zinc, manganese, boron, whatever you need. Buffer them with the carbon if at all possible, ideally humics. put it down. There is always a window of time in the early spring, the ground is thawed and not wet, and the grass has not yet started to grow. Everybody know that window of time?
No.
No.
I don't.
It's fleeting.
You said not wet, I think that was.
There's always a window of time. I mean, and if there's not, that window of time, as soon as possible. But basically, when the grass, when the sod is, you know, spends the winter frozen solid, it dies back. The root system dies back. And just as the ground thaws out, is when it starts to, you know, send out new roots to reestablish itself. And if you can turn it over at that moment, you can take out sod very easily. If you wait 2 weeks and those roots start growing, it's a totally different animal. But if you can get in there early and just, I mean, you don't need to do much above the top inch to take the top off the sod. You can really just about take out a whole hay field with almost no tillage at all if you do it in that window of time. And sometimes perhaps you're gonna have the top inch is thawed and you still got some, the ground is frozen underneath, great, do it then. Take the top inch off. Whatever you're, if you're in a low wet area and you're not gonna get any dry soil until long after the grass starts growing, put your minerals down now, till it under as soon as possible. Ideally, I'd like to put a cover crop in there. If you are gonna be planting spring crops, you're gonna be planting spring crops, how much I can do. I would ideally like to put a cover crop in for at least, you know, one cycle before.
There's one place that I might be able to crop, mm-hmm. and it has some cover crops in it. They left it fallow, but cover cropped it basically, mm-hmm. is what they did for yeah. a year. And go ahead and put the minerals in now.
Put them on ASAP.
Yeah, okay.
If you've got a compost pile, if you've got a cooking compost pile, throw them in there, they'll cook for a little while.
Yeah, right.
And, you know, put your basic fertilizer down, prepare your beds, go for it.
Okay, question two on minerals. Yes. One thing I hadn't checked into, but we have plenty of sandstone in our area.
Sandstone.
Is that a good, how does that compare? You mentioned basalt.
I mentioned basalt specifically in a second.
It's tough granite. To find around here, I think.
I've been told.
Granite out your way.
You guys
more likely.
Finally have something.
Sandstone
that
is
we
good.
Don't. You don't have something we have.
Sandstone and limestone are the ones
yeah.
that we have.
We also have soil.
Yeah, right, right. Your granite will be soil in yeah.
between
how many
now
million
and
years?
Yeah, exactly. If no one has anything.
But
yeah.
You know anything about, do you know anything about how sandstone dust would?
I don't. You have to do a proper assay.
Okay.
You know the prospecting labs that are oftentimes in Canada are the best. You want a full mineral assay of everything's in it. And if you don't find at least 40 minerals, 40 specific different elements, it's probably not worth it. Mm-hmm. Okay. 25 or 30 is a definite minimum. A lot of those things are mostly all silicon oxide.
And the quarries may have that information.
You're looking for a quarry where they're blasting, they're drilling and blasting hard rock and crushing it, and they've got a byproduct, which is dust. That's what you're looking for? We had this conversation last night.
They mill it, is what they do.
What's that?
They mill the stone into, you know, building materials.
The sandstone.
Yes.
I don't think sandstone's going to be what you're looking for. I don't think sandstone's going to be what
you need.
Going to have what you want.
Yeah,
what's that?
You need granite.
You need basalt,
yeah.
And you'll take granite.
Because the silicon, that's where you're getting your silica.
Yeah, right, right.
You want a lot more than silica. Silica's great. They've all got silica. You want the extra 40 minerals in good doses. What you're looking for is a geological map of the state or your region, whether it's on the state border or whatever it is. You would like to find old volcanic, magma flows or volcanic calderas. If there's any kind of old, you know, 50 million years old, 300 million years old, I don't care how old it is. If it's a volcanic, you know, material, it'll be basaltic. It'll have a very nice spectrum of trace elements, and it'll probably have a nice paramagnetic charge as well. And it's worth driving an extra 100 miles for that. Yes.
Yeah. When you say to put it down now, the mineral and other, we have snow. Yeah, we have snow on it. We just
yes.
put over the snow.
That's what I do.
Okay.
If you're on the side of a hill and you feel like it's all gonna, you know, things are gonna wash, run down
uh-huh.
the hill. Perhaps you should be a little more cautious. I'm not sure what kind of soil would have to run out anyways. If you've got, if you're worried about nitrogen runoff from manure, that's one thing. If you're worried about minerals actually running out the side of the hill, I wouldn't be so concerned about that.
Okay. Well, and my other thing that I have amended this topsoil, I mean, how you add it now, I mean, this big pile, I have, you know, at least 10 cubic feet. And I need to...
Is it frozen solid or...
I think so, it's hard.
I bet your top 3 inches are hard, but you chop through that underneath the salt inside.
So you just break it apart and put the stuff in there?
Take the top off. You know, the top looks like a little, it's like that, you know, cream on top of yogurt. You flip that off and the rest of it's all loose.
And then put it in there?
Yeah.
Okay.
Just get in there.
Remember, chemical reactions take place with more water.
Yeah.
I mean, if it can't get down there, it's gonna just sit on top. That's why I said, if you don't have moisture, forget mineralizing. Because you're wasting time. What do you think about Pfeiffer's preps, biodynamic preps? Have you used that in conjunction with some of these products? Because we spent a fortune in trying to get the calcium and everything balanced. And yes, we did see profound changes. But what do you think about Pfeiffer's preparations that they normally add to compost, but actually applying them to the field? Have you seen much of that? Because I'm experimenting with it this year.
I don't have enough experience to speak intelligently on biodynamics. I think that Steiner is up to some pretty interesting things. Anybody know how to explain what Steiner's up to?
I do, I just haven't seen the results, and that's why this year I'll have some information.
Being able to truly understand what he's up to, I think is, you know, takes a certain amount of deep understanding. And I feel intuitively good about those things, where they're at, and the level of importance. I feel like, I was just thinking about this the other day, I mean, I spent a good amount of time esoterically oriented, living in the Himalayas, you know, off studying Eastern traditions, and got to a state where I was, you know, felt like I had, you know, a pretty good working relationship with all that stuff. And it became quite clear to me that if I didn't get my physical form in shape, all that energy was not going to any good use. And I feel like, I mean, people who know me for a while know that I get very excited about all sorts of energetic things. I've got a bunch of them, it has 4 pages of these slides. But I do think it's very important for us to not forget the foundational basics. And if we can't get the physical form basically functioning, then we're misprioritizing. Once the physical form is decently in shape, then you start to bring in all those subtle energies and spin and vortexes and, you know, all that stuff, and you can have some really, really cool stuff happen. But if you don't get the basic mineral balancing and the basic trace elements and the, you know, basic tillage and all that stuff management going, you're never going to see the results you otherwise see. So it sounds like maybe you already got a lot of that going on.
I'm trying.
In which case, you know, go for it.
Yeah.
I certainly like a compost that's got all those things in it. A good compost will have those biodynamic preparations in it.
Well, if you look at Reams and Dr. Ulbrich and rest of them trying to get the calcium, magnesium, all those macros in place,
mm-hmm.
and you look at what Fiber was doing, you know, based on the direction, you know, you're adding chamomile to the sulfur, and you've got all those elements that they're trying to fix with those homeopathic type dosages. And I'm looking forward to seeing the results, because it costs tens of thousands if you're doing, like we did a 20-acre field, we spent $10,000.
Mm-hmm.
To get about, of course, it's doing magnificent now.
Well, if you're making $25,000 per acre, and it's cost you $10,000 to do 20 acres, then your investment cost, if you were any kind of businessman on any other kind of business, that would be a steal.
It is.
Right? So don't begrudge it.
Yeah.
I've seen plenty of biodynamic farmers who have pretty cyclical produce who are religious about their application and preparations.
Is that interesting?
And they focus all on the preparations, and they forget the foundational minerals.
Right.
And Steiner talked about the mineral form, the physical stuff, along with everything else.
Yeah, he did.
And some of his followers like to talk about the energy and forget about the physical. I think the foundation of the physical form is very important. And then if you get that, you can, you know, go to higher planes more readily.
Kind of like the cell phone call you're talking about.
Something like the cell phone call.
Yeah.
Yeah. And all those inoculants will help tune in. But if you don't have the mineral in place, it's much harder. Okay, starless sod, what do you do now? Lid on minerals, greenhouse soil and disturbed soils are my last two questions. Okay, So that was your question, and who's, who else's question? Your question. You guys want to just lay out what you're dealing with? Your disturbed soils.
I'm in an urban area.
Yes.
Structures removed from the properties, sometimes with basements or not.
Yeah.
Most of the construction debris supposedly was removed.
Yeah.
Supposedly clean fill was brought in to fill in the holes and bring things up to grade, cover up maybe some dicey human activity from unknown, you know, or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Seeds were spread, grass and weeds and stuff have grown. We're not talking about bottomland that's been there for 10,000 years after the glaciers and, or, you know, fertile deltas or anything. We're talking about this truckload had clay, this truckload had, who knows what the truckloads had in them. They varied depending on what was available for free or low cost.
Right. Okay.
So how do you fix that, or how do you make that work? Where do you start?
You start with, as a good doctor would, with a history and physical. You find out as much information as possible about what are the different areas you're working with, and say, this area over here is all gravel fill, this area is clay, this area is actually the native topsoil, and this is just a brown field. And, you know, you have to suss that out by seeing what's growing where, digging it up, getting a penetrometer there, doing some pores, and seeing what's going on there. And you really have to treat each, you know, area that is unique as a unique organism to bring them all back into play and try to get them to function as a complete organism. So you can't treat your sandy area the same way you can treat your clay area, the same way you can treat your regular land area. I would figure out what's going on there, see what the underlying, you know, nature of the material is, and, you know, following the basic mineral balancing program and cover cropping and mulching and all that kind of stuff, you can build soil just about anywhere. But you're gonna have different needs and imbalances in this area than you are in that. So you have to treat them separately. If everything's got mixed up and treated uniquely, get an assay of that and treat it uniquely. Treat it all the same. I think that one of the biggest issues that I would be worried about in an environment like that are heavy metals, carcinogens of numerous sorts, whether it's lead or chromium or PCBs or, you know, any long list of things. And, that's part of what makes me, you know, have to say to people, do you know how cheap land is out in the country? Because for $10,000, you could get yourself a couple acres and actually, you know, live a really different kind of quality of life. But you city people are sometimes set in your ways, and you know what you want to do. So I would say that molasses and humates and a little bit of seawater are great things to be systemically feeding the soil with. I would be inoculating my soil. I'd be running sequences of cover crops, deep-rooted cover crops, opening up cover crops, as many cycles as you can until you feel like that soil is in a basic state to begin growing food crops on. I would definitely run toxicology kind of tests, looking for, you know, systemic carcinogens for the heavy metals, and seeing what those levels will drop over time, which they should do. And the more you can feed the soil life, the more they will digest those carcinogens, and the more they'll complex the toxins. But I would be very active about feeding the soil life, running cover crops, foliar spraying cover crops, and really trying to systemically build a biological system before trying to grow crops. Sufficient?
Start.
For now? Okay. You had a question about greenhouses and building. You're putting in a new greenhouse in a low soil, low spot?
Yeah, so we probably have to fill a nova, which is a very much
full.
16 inches. We just want to fill it up so the water doesn't get in there. Hardly ever floods, but
you put it on a low spot. I mean, does it go down anywhere else? Is there any lower spots around it, or that's as you put the greenhouse right in the bottom?
It's pretty big flat spot.
Yeah.
But if we just fill it up a little bit, it wouldn't flood in there.
Yeah. I don't know, you don't have access to any kind of soil around, sitting around?
Well, yes, I can get some, but I was just curious what's good to get, or should we take the topsoil out and just, that's there, put other soil in, and then put that on?
I would probably be more likely to dig some kind of perimeter drainage. If your issue is maybe water occasionally, I would try to find a somewhat lower spot and dig some drains, you know, dig some on the edges of the greenhouse just so you can channel it away.
Rather than filling it up.
Rather than going through the very complicated process of taking the soil out, filling it up, that sounds much more of a hassle. Yeah. If soil's there, I'd like to leave it if at all possible. Once you dig it up and start playing with it, it doesn't like it. So just let soil be, feed it, let it grow, but moving it around and replacing it it's not just a physical form. There's something about its connection to everything else that I don't understand, but seems to be very true.
Come to the Mark Shepherd workshop and learn about how to harvest the water up uphill. Yeah, right.
It's all common sense. Just go out and look at the lay of the land and see where the trenches need to go.
You can, if it's not too severe, you can usually just take care of it and let it soak in uphill. And there's ways to do that, even if you're right in the middle of a valley that's flowing right down into your greenhouse, you can probably, or whatever, you know, you can still take care of it.
I had a problem with that, and I just did raised beds.
Well, I would always do raised beds anyways.
I'm in the, where your aisleways get pretty, well,
it doesn't take, I mean, you need almost no grade to get water to move.
Yeah.
I mean, if you can see that it's all lower over there, if you can see it, then just dig a trench and it'll be gone. Just if you can see it with your eyeball, that's enough for it to move. It takes almost no grade to get water to move. All right. So what time do we have?
Quarter to four.
Quarter to four. We got 45 minutes left formally. I could do a full speed review of seminal thinkers. I could leave that for you to peruse at your own leisure and answer more questions. I'd be happy to do either. I basically have these last four pages as people I think are important who have offered what I consider to be seminal insight into living systems that is oftentimes information most people have never been exposed to, and if it was portrayed in a non-nuanced fashion, you think would belong it. You know, people have found out a lot of stuff which is really interesting and oftentimes pushes the envelopes of what we understand about reality. So. 45 minutes is not really enough time to go over all these. I'm happy to do a sort of find one you want, and I'll talk about it if you'd like. Anyone wants to do it that way, or do question and answer. See, so the last four pages are, you know, critical thoughts that expand upon this understanding of a biological system.
Let's move on to Mei-Wan Ho.
Mei-Wan Ho?
Yeah.
Mei-Wan Ho. Is the founder of an organization called Institute of Science and Society. She's of Chinese origin, currently based in Great Britain. She has coined the term quantum jazz to refer to what's actually happening in living systems. This 0.0000001 number, 1 × 10⁻¹⁴, is the of a second, is how fast atoms vibrate. So every molecule, every atom in our body, every single one, we've got 4 trillion cells, and each cell is made out of a whole bunch of atoms. Every single atom, every single molecule is vibrating 1 × 10⁻¹⁴ times per second, or 1 × 10⁻¹⁴ times per second, which is a very, very large number, right? Everything's vibrating extremely rapidly. And the point she's trying to make here is that every single one of those vibrations is, it's like it's a instrument in a orchestra, but it's a jazz orchestra. And so somebody modulates to a different key and they put out that note, then all the rest of the molecules all modulate slightly and shift to that different key. So every time you add a new mineral or a compound into a cell, it shifts the whole vibration of the whole cell in extraordinarily fast time. And so you've got these feedback loops that can happen in living systems at an extraordinarily rapid rate. It's just a, I don't know if she said it, it's like a 26 octave, you know, jazz symphony operating at, you know, this amazingly rapid speed. That's what living systems are, right? It's this amazingly sophisticated, complicated, profound feedback loop. And there's no way we can ever identify and isolate every single causal factor and predict this is going to cause this to happen, this is going to cause this to happen, because it's just, it's this whole symphony. And, you know, A, it's talking about the sort of the awesomeness of living systems, but B, seems to me to be some of the best information that I can put my hands on that sort of explains how foliar sprays can work, how adding one atom of, you know, iodine, you know, or, you know, 2 grams of iodine per acre can have, you know, a dramatic effect on plant physiological development in 24 hours, right? I mean, you can add very, very small quantities of minerals, extremely small quantities of minerals, and have, you know, you add some chromium, and all of a sudden there's way more potassium in the plant, because that chromium was at the core of the enzyme that was needed by this mineral, for this, you know, bacteria to facilitate the potassium solubilization process. There's this amazing feedback loop that happens, and it's extremely rapid. And that's the speed of life is much faster than what we take part in or perceive. But little things at the right time, at the right place, can have, you know, massive cascading effects. Not the most elegant explanation of her work. She's done a lot of other good, interesting work, but yeah.
Does she bring up the point that it's the vibrations and basically the physics part of science that is higher, or it's the speed of it all that is this, all this communication.
That causes the physical form.
Is the wavelengths, it's the vibration of the communication between these cells, and it's acting and working faster than, for example, chemistry is going on. The chemistry is slower. We're very chemistry-oriented science culture.
Yeah.
And we downplay the physics of the vibrations of
that's a central issue.
Is that what she's bringing up here? Or
not? I'm not sure. I'm not well enough versed with all of her work to be able to speak specifically on that. I know she's looked at a lot of those interesting overlapping areas. But yeah, I mean, there's no question that I think a central issue is that we still believe that, you know, we believe in matter. You know, Einstein said 100 years ago that all matter is energy, right? That it's the energetic substrate which creates the physical form. It's that frequency of vibration that shifts into, that you know, comes down into form. You get the frequency first and the form, you know, later. And Einstein said that a long time ago. You know, it's been proven numerous times, and we still believe in form.
Genesis says let
there be Genesis, light. Yeah,
light,
I mean, that you can go anywhere you want. And then it was just, you know, and then he said something, and, you know, yeah. I mean, it comes down through the frequency octaves into form, and form is the last, is the gross substrate of these higher frequencies. And if we can understand how to work with frequencies, which is what Reams was doing, Reams is not looking at minerals for, you know, minerals for their mineral aspect. He was looking at minerals for their vibratory frequency. And he said this calcium has this frequency and this calcium has that frequency, and all calciums are not even. And that seems to be true. You can add 200 pounds of this gypsum and 200 pounds of this gypsum,